I intend to tell in this video how I minister to satanically ritually abused persons, and I want to show that it is not difficult. When I say that to other counselors, they think I'm out of my mind. If we think the ministry is difficult, it's because we're doing it ourselves and not letting the Lord do it. Now, I realize when I say that, a lot of people don't understand what I mean when I say, let the Lord do it. And so that's what I'm going to be describing here in the series. All I do is pray, and I bring the presence of the Lord to the ministry session. And then I pray for the person I'm ministering to. I ask questions, and then God interacts with that person directly. And it doesn't have to be through me. I'm just there as kind of a facilitator, or I'm like a catalyst that makes the interaction happen. So I would just like to talk a little bit about that here so that you understand what I'm saying. I have many videos on satanic ritual abuse on YouTube, so I'm going to assume as you're listening to this, you've probably heard some of my other videos, or you have a general knowledge of what satanic ritual abuse is and what the needs are of the people that are receiving this ministry. Perhaps you've been involved in the ministry yourself, or you have been a recipient of the ministry. So this is how I do it. I begin with prayer. I don't use anybody else's prayers. I don't read prayers. I don't have the people I'm ministering to read prayers. It's all from the heart. It's all out of relationship with God. And so I begin something like this. Lord Jesus, we ask your presence here today to minister to Charlie, for example. That's not his name. I've never ministered to anybody named Charlie. So we can use that as an example. So I ask the Lord's presence to be with us. And then I just say some things to the Lord to indicate how much we need his help. Lord, we realize that of ourselves, we can do nothing to minister to Charlie. We don't know what happened. We don't know where to begin. So, Lord, we just commit this whole ministry into your hands and ask God that you would bring forth the part that we need to talk with today. Lord, you've been with Charlie his entire life. You know absolutely everything that ever happened to him. You know where all the parts are located and all the demons. So, Lord, we just want to release your spirit to do the ministry today. And once I pray that, then I might start asking some questions like, is there someone in Charlie that would be willing to share today something you know so that Charlie can get better? We know a lot of things have happened to him that were so bad he could not bear to even remember them, and so he split off into many different parts. And so all of you have important parts of the puzzle here to help Charlie get better. And the way he's going to get better is if you begin to talk about it. If you keep quiet about what happened, then the cult can have power over you. If you keep quiet about what happened, you're going to stay in darkness and pain and despair. But the way to come out is to talk about what happened. And if you are afraid of the demons, you don't have to be afraid of them because Jesus is here. He is Almighty God. He has all power over the demons. And all I have to do is bind the demons, and they cannot hurt you. So right now, in the name of Jesus, I bind every demon that would try to hinder the ministry to Charlie today. And Lord, I ask that you would bring forth the part you want us to talk with today. And then I wait a little bit and give the person some time. And very often, a part will begin to talk and tell me something that happened. Now, everybody is different. Sometimes a part talks directly to me, and sometimes they don't talk to me at all. They talk to Charlie, and they tell him what happens. And Charlie might say, well, I'm beginning to see myself. I'm sitting on a chair, and my hands are tied behind my back. And so then I ask, well, what happened after that? And he says, I don't know. Well, this is when I employ some knowledge I have of this kind of abuse. when the abuse gets really bad, the person splits into another part. And so one memory may be contained in 3, 4, 5 or more parts. So then I just talk to the next person. I say, does anybody know what happened after he was seated in a chair with his hands behind his back? Does anyone know what happened next? And so we wait a little bit, and pretty soon someone else comes forth and says, well, they were torturing me. And then we begin to get more of the story. It's important that we keep asking questions until we get the whole story. What I'm talking about here as an example with Charlie is an actual example of some ministry I helped someone through this morning. And so he did see himself seated on a chair with his hands tied behind his back, and he didn't remember what happened. And so I ask, who knows what happened next? And the person says, I was being interrogated, and there were these people asking me questions and torturing me to get the answer, but I had no idea what their question even meant. I didn't have the information they wanted, but they just kept torturing me. And so I talked to different parts. Whenever they stop talking, I say, okay, who knows what happened next? And so I get the story, and I hear all the different things they did to torture him, which I'm not going to tell you because there's no point to having to hear these bad things. And then he says, and the next thing I know, I woke up in bed. So all I've heard here is that he's being interrogated and asked questions about something he has no idea what the answer is. And they torture him. It gets worse and worse and worse. And then finally his next memory is he's waking up in bed. Well, I know something has been left out. If he wakes up at home in bed and he's been tortured, something's missing, because they had a purpose to this torture. They wanted to do something with him. And they were torturing him to getting him to the point where they could do whatever it was they wanted. And so I find out that what they wanted was to get him so angry that a demon manifests. And this demon manifested as a power that the people wanted to get something they deemed necessary for whatever it is they were going to do. I'm not going to give the details here, but what they did was they got power for what they wanted to do. And so once I found that out, I thought, okay, we've got the whole memory here. So now what do we do with the memory? Well, we want to defuse it. And the first thing we do is ask the person, are you willing to forgive the people that did this to you? And if the people are really serious about getting better, they'll say yes, because they know if they hold unforgiveness in their heart, they're just going to be in bondage, and that doesn't help them at all. And it doesn't hurt the perpetrators, because that was done years ago, and whether or not they forgive means nothing to the perpetrators, but it's certainly going to lock this person up in torment if they don't forgive. We need to identify the lies the person believed, because when we believe lies, that gives demons permission to torment us. And so I will say, Lord Jesus, would you please show Charlie some of the lies he believes because of what he went through? And then Charlie says, oh, the Lord is showing me that I believe that I'll always be put in hopeless situations where people are demanding things of me I cannot possibly give them. And so he renounces that lie in the name of Jesus, and he proclaims the truth, that in Jesus Christ there is always hope, and the Lord will not leave him in hopeless situations. So once you renounce the lie, demons will often start coming out. And sometimes they don't come out till you proclaim the truth. But what you're doing is you're removing all grounds they have to be there. And so once they come out, they'll stay out, and you won't have any trouble with them again, because you have diffused this memory. You have taken away their legal rights to be there. And then sometimes people have made vows. You need to ask the question, Lord, did Charlie make any vows when he was going through this? And Charlie will say, no vows. And so we don't have to do that. But sometimes they have to swear allegiance to Satan or something like that. And we have to deal with that. We want to be sure that we deal with all the demons that are related to this particular memory. Sometimes I ask the Lord to push up any more demons that he wants us to deal with, and he always does. Another important part of diffusing the memory is the release of emotions. We want the person to be releasing the anger, the fear, the horror, the pain, whatever is related to that memory. We need to encourage them to release it. I keep a big foam pillow with a fresh pillowcase on it at close at hand, so if the person needs to scream or yell or beat on it, that pillow is handy for them to release emotions. And then I ask Jesus to minister to the parts. He knows what they need. He knows how many there are. And so I just release him to minister. I don't see what he does, but the person I'm ministering to does, and they'll often tell me what the Lord does. And then the Lord will either take them, the parts with them, to a safe place inside the person, or he might merge them into the person. I always leave that up to the Lord. And then I ask Jesus if there's anything else he wants to do. And sometimes there is, sometimes there isn't. And so this should then, what I've been talking about here, should leave the person much better than they were when they came into the session, and everything's dealt with and there's no dangling loose ends to cause any problems for this person. This is just one example of how the ministry might proceed. It's not always like this. As I've said before, everybody is different. But this gives you a good example of what I mean when I say, let Jesus do the ministry. Everything is done by prayer. I don't have any predetermined agenda. I don't open the ministry session by saying, okay, today we're going to deal with anger and we're going to go to level 4 and deal with blah, 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 blah. I don't do that at all. I always start with asking God what he wants to do and let him be in charge. If you found this helpful, I have more videos and many articles at my website, www.hispresenceonline.org.